Do you want to play video?
Oh, did I already played video.
I completely missed that.
All right.
So we haven't practiced this talk. Mike and I actually met 8 years ago at Shmoocon. We met on the internet, but first, and he said, let's submit a talk to Shmoocon. And we met on the Friday afternoon. And then we went to his hotel room, which is apparently his MO. And and we worked on our slide deck and practiced our demos. And 8 years later, we did exactly the same thing yesterday afternoon. We missed a bunch of One Track Mind because we were like, oh, we should make those demos work. So we have a bunch of working demos and a lot of hardware for you. And most of this talk is going to be demo and very little slide content. And we are going to write a paper for the proceedings, which will have a lot more like text information and stuff like that in it. So I'm Dominic Spill. This is Mike Ossmann, and I work for Great Scott Gadgets. This is me. I like pictures of myself looking stupid. I have these glasses. I work on Ubertooth. I work on HackerF. I usually do the software side of things, and Mike designs the hardware. These are already offensive to me. In the picture on screen, they were. I was at an event at New Year, and they were audio activated. And like New Year's Day, I was looking at this like IR transistor I had, and I was looking at the glasses, and I was looking at the transistor, the glasses, and I was like, ah, how hard can it be? And so right now, I have replaced the microphone on them with an IR transistor, and they're IR activated. So we built a couple of pairs because that's what our time is worth. And if you're in the previous talk, obviously they called out a couple of our products and things. FCC.io is just a shortcut method for looking up those FCC documents that they were talking about, which I wrote. This is Mike. He's somewhat disapproving.
Can you tell who wrote these slides?
Oh, yeah. I mean, oh, yeah. I completely forgot. I'm extraordinary. That is official. If you're an American citizen, your government said that. Mike, not so much. Mike is my boss, and hopefully still is after these slides. And he designs all the hardware at Grayscale Gadgets, and then hands it to me, and I try to make it work with the software. You probably recognize some of the things we build, HackerF, which is the kind of the biggest one. Ubertooth, which is a kind of a labor of love for us and has been a bit of a passion for 8 years. It's like the talk we spoke at Shmoocon about, like our first talk at Shmoocon was about the code that's still in the Ubertooth project and some other things. And today we're talking about infrared, and the platform we're building that on top of is GreatFET, which is a microcontroller platform that we've developed largely based on the HackerF. But to give us an opportunity to explore interesting chips that we can find and things like that, and we'll come on to more about it in a minute. So you all think of infrared, hopefully you've all thought about infrared before coming to the talk, and you think TV remotes, maybe some toys, maybe IRDA, Palm Pilots, the remote controls and things, and stuff like that. And you probably thought of the 90s, because that's the last time anyone thought it was relevant. But there's a whole load more stuff that uses infrared now. In fact, there's more infrared devices than ever before, and it's used in all sorts of different methods at different data rates and doing very strange things with it. So today we're mostly looking at near-infrared, which is very close to the visible spectrum. Far-infrared is much closer to the radio part of the spectrum. And if you see, I've mentioned heat on the slide. And heat, a lot of people think of those FLIR camera modules, and things like that that I know a few people have looked at in the past. I think Vist did some stuff on them a couple of years ago. And they tend to work in the far infrared, and we're looking at near infrared. So we're looking at data transfer and things like that. We're specifically looking, it's very hot. Oh yeah, we're based out of Colorado, and clearly the Google filter bubble is alive and well, because this was top result when I searched for light spectrum. I make no further comment. So we're looking at the stuff like very close, like probably about 800 nanometers to 1,000 nanometers. It's kind of very close to that red section, not as far down if you see on the, I don't know if I got a cursor on here. Not anywhere near this microwave section, this end of infrared, but we're up here right next to light and things like that. And that's where most communication happens. So the first step was to build some hardware, and Mike was busy that day, so I took a run at it. And this is what it looks like. And this is genuinely the first draft of our research hardware. I bought an IR transistor and a resistor from Mouser for $2 and then paid $20 shipping or something. And we honestly had a conversation at some point where Mike went, oh, good choice on the 4.7K ohm. Like, that's the right resistor to use. And I was like, is it? I thought you chose it. He's like, no, I thought you chose it. So this just kind of magically happened. And then we plug this into the analog to digital converter on GreatFET, or any microcontroller, but GreatFET. And the circuit diagram looks like this. I'm actually so good at hardware that you may notice one of these lines wasn't drawn in until afterwards because my circuit diagram was completely missing this very important line, which I then added in probably something equivalent to Microsoft Paint. But essentially, the more infrared we get over on that transistor, the more current it conducts, and therefore, yeah, I got it right? Okay, more current it conducts. the more current it conducts, and the more greater the voltage across that 4.7K resistor. And basically, we're sampling that with an analog to digital converter, so we get a value in our microcontroller that is related to the amount of infrared hitting the transistor, and then magic things happen. And that's basically how the glasses work as well. But it turns out that is not the greatest hardware in the world for sniffing infrared. So Mike designed something which he's going to talk about now.
So I really like Dominic's original hardware because it shows you the essential elements that are required in order to do the stuff that we're talking about. You really don't need a lot of hardware necessarily. And the technique that we're talking about today is applying the concept or the technique of software-defined radio to infrared. So if you were here in the last hour and saw Matt and Mark talking about software-defined radio tools and how easy they are to use these days, we're going to use the same exact tools, except we're going to apply them to infrared. And instead of sampling radio signals with an analog-to-digital converter, we're sampling infrared signals with an analog-to-digital converter. And all we need is some platform with an analog-to-digital converter and a circuit that could be as simple as this plugged into it. But we wanted to go a little further and make a platform that could really explore all the infrared systems around us, something that could operate at very high frequencies and very low frequencies of modulation, and really have a universal tool. And so I designed this add-on for the GreatFET that we call add-ons neighbors. So this neighbor is called Gladiolus. That's just the working code name for it. And this is the first working revision that we have a photo of here and that we have here with us today. Basically, most of the components that are on there are part of this receive path that has a photodiode to detect the infrared, and then a bunch of amplification with variable gain. And right now, the gain is controlled by turning a little potentiometer, but we can also, in the future, we'll be able to control it by just from the microcontroller. So we could do automatic gain control and stuff like that. But this is just the first working rev, so we're still turning the knob. And then there's an analog to digital converter on there that's a higher speed analog to digital converter than the one that is built into the microcontroller on GreatFET. So we're able to sample at a much higher rate, up to 40 megasamples per second is our goal. Today we're running at 10 megasamples per second. We have a little bit of an issue with our clock signal that keeps us from going a whole lot higher than that. But that's plenty fast enough for everything that we've tried to hack on with it so far. But in the future we're going to up the sample rate to probably in the 20 to 40 megasample per second range. And the goal is to be able to sample infrared that is modulated at frequencies anywhere from DC, 0 hertz, all the way up to 10 megahertz. We have yet to identify any targets that are modulated, target systems that are modulated faster than 10 megahertz, so this should be good enough for us. You can see there's kind of a big empty area at the bottom. That's getting filled up I have a design that we, for the next rev that we haven't finished yet, where that gets filled up with a more sophisticated transmit path. Right now, the transmit path is just that that clear LED that you see in the lower right-hand corner, and we're just turning it off and on with a GPIO pin. So we only have like one bit of output, whereas we have 8 bits of input very fast. So the analog section of the whole receive path is fairly sophisticated and pretty close to what we think the final version will be. The transmit path is still fairly unsophisticated, but we're going to add a digital to analog converter and then the whole kind of SDR style transmit path to control that LED, whereas for now we're only switching it on and off with one bit, but that's good enough for most of the things that we're working with anyway. So it's fine for now. But let's do a demo here. I really need to take these glasses off. Yeah. Wow, okay. Because we might need to be able to see for some of this stuff. Do we have a gladiolus?
Yeah, so we've done a thing of bringing loads of demo gear, and I'm not sure where we put the actual hardware we're going to use. So Mike's just retreat. There we go.
There we go.
Retrieving it from his bag.
That's all right. Or maybe this side.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to explain the
tool.
Okay, so what I did with the original hardware, the bad hardware, let's call it, is I built some Python code on the host that dumps the samples from the ADC into a FIFO, and then we just took a GNU radio flow graph from our like SDR experience and read those samples back into GNU radio, and now we can do all the things we can do with SDR, but with infrared. And that technique still applies to the gladiolus board with the higher sample rates and the better receive chain. And so as you can see, Mike can then start working his SDR magic on the infrared that we received from the gladiolus and Greatfoot. You need to.
I need to
do the Greatfoot ABC.
Yeah. So we have this in GNU radio. Where am I? In GNU radio, we have this Greatfoot source that isn't working very reliably yet, but we're working on it. And so right now I'm running a file source through a name pipe. Oh, that's not going to work because I haven't made the pipe. Or maybe I have. I don't know. We'll see. Is there a slash? What's that? Oh, yeah, sure. The text isn't super important, but you'll see more interesting things in a moment. So because we don't have the, what am I looking for? ADC. This is what I want to do.
Yep.
Oh, no, that's right. Okay. So anyway, I'm just using a command line tool to dump samples, stream samples from the Greatfoot, and then dump them into this name pipe. And then my flow graph will actually be running because it's getting input on that file, which is a name pipe. So at the top, we have like an oscilloscope kind of view of the signal coming in from the photodiode. And on the bottom, we're using phosphor, which gives us kind of a waterfall plot. You were looking at spectrograms that Matt and Mark showed you in the last hour. And in the bottom there, you can see that kind of thing. So right now, Dominic is pointing a remote control. This is what, a DirecTV remote control or something, pointing it at there. And you can see some things going on. We can do a frequency analysis down here at the bottom, but we can also look at the waveform up at the top. And if I like trigger on it or something, I can kind of analyze what's going on there. And what's going on here is that you see a whole train of pulses, and the frequency of this pulse train is 38 kilohertz, which is very, very common in remote controls and toys and like low-cost consumer infrared stuff, is that you always use, everything's 38 kilohertz. Not everything, but most things are 38 kilohertz. And the exceptions are usually somewhere in the ballpark of 38 kilohertz. They're like tens of kilohertz. And if I kind of zoom out, can you give me some more of that?
Yep.
If I zoom out, come on. What's going on? Don't I know how to use it?
It's crashed.
Thanks, Nick. Oh, did it crash?
Yeah, full speed crash.
Oh, huh. What's going on? Let's try this again. It may be a name pipe issue. Anyway, if I kind of zoom out a bit, give me some more there. So if I zoom out a lot, here, that's a good kind of level right there, where you can see, okay, trigger's good. Triggers are helpful. Although you're giving me enough data that it really doesn't matter too much. So here we can see the 38 kilohertz pulse train, but then you, when I zoom out more, you can see that there are like groups of pulses that are different lengths, and so what we're seeing here really is on-off keying. We saw on-off keying in the last hour with the radio protocol. And so to a radio person like me, this just looks like on-off keying with a 38 kilohertz carrier. That's exactly what we're seeing here. Now, there's a fundamental difference between the software-defined radio approach and the software-defined infrared approach in that I'm not seeing the actual waveform of the over-the-air electromagnetic wave. This is not a 38 kilohertz electromagnetic carrier, right? This is hundreds of terahertz electromagnetic carrier, right? Almost to the visible spectrum. We don't have radio technology. I can't build a radio circuit in my lab that operates at hundreds of terahertz. Now, we're heading in that direction, right? There's some cutting edge technology heading in that direction. But for something low cost, built out of photodiodes and LEDs and things, we don't have the ability to directly deal with terahertz plus signals on our low-cost circuits. So what we do is we use something like a photodiode that is a detector that essentially demodulates, it does sort of an amplitude demodulation of the electromagnetic wave. And then we're investigating that demodulated signal and thinking of it like a radio signal. So there is this fundamental difference there, that there's that sort of amplitude modulation and demodulation that happens at the LED or the photodiode that we can't get away from. We're always going to have that with this type of system. But that's not really a limitation, because the target systems that we're working with, they have the same limitation. And so we can kind of fully describe what they're doing with this technique. And we can do things like fingerprint systems by nuances in their difference in timing. We can fingerprint systems by exactly the frequency that they're using versus another system. We could have two different remote controls in the same room and probably tell them apart because they're slightly off frequency from each other and stuff like that that you couldn't do without taking this sort of SDR approach. It's, oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. Do you want to try the duck?
Okay. So, there's some explanation needed here.
I, as I previously stated, I recently moved from the UK to the US, and I discovered that, like, you'll like guns. So, I bought one. sorry, a gun safety shouldn't point it at the crowd. So it comes with a duck, and the duck does this, and the idea is, like, you got to shoot the duck three times and it dies, right? And we were playing around with infrared. I mean, like, I bought this well before the infrared project started, because it's awesome. And we tried to do this. Do you want to bring up the green radio photograph? And tried to look at the... Hey, that worked. Oh, I bet this microphone works too. And we tried to look at like what signal was coming out of here, and I'd love to say this was like a scientific process whereby we kind of tried to look at what was going on and like investigate the signal, and...
Triggering. Yeah. Triggering's good.
Set the trigger, yep. That's it. Okay. Ready?
Yeah.
And okay. what we got was a 38 kilohertz wave, and... like, as we've previously stated, all these remotes work at 38 kilohertz. So we figured, well, this takes a while. Like, the skill in this is, like, the timing and the aim and things like that. And it's got a very narrow, like, spread of the infrared. But it turns out DirecTV, we're not interested in making it hard to...
Wait, how do you turn it on?
There's a switch on the bottom.
How do you turn the duck on? Oh, there.
So it turns out, like, in order to win this game, the real key is to just hold this remote down and it dies instantly.
Yes.
I'm so glad that demo worked because that's my favorite. And I'd love to say we found that out by analyzing the waveforms, but what actually happened is Taylor, who's one of the other people at Great Scott Gadgets, pulled out the remote and went, I wonder if this will work, and it did. So he's just smart like that. So that's the tool that we've built, and I think next we'll go back to the slides.
Sure.
I don't know how to work your window manager, sorry.
Yeah, I kind of do.
Yeah.
There. Oh yeah.
So, like as we said, like all these things work at 38 kilohertz. This toy works there. The remotes work there. Things like that. And this is very similar to what Mike was just showing in the GNU Radio flow graph. This is just on a scope in the lab. But what you've got is you've got the terahertz carrier being demodulated by the diode. You've got the 38 kilohertz signal and that's being pulsed, and you're getting a 200 hertz, a 200 bits per second signal with those big peaks, and that's how it's carrying information. So it's fairly low data rate. And we were interested if there were things, well, we know IRDA exists, we know there are things at higher data rates, so what else is out there? And then I'd submitted my KiwiCon talk and someone said, oh, infrared, it's funny. Like, nothing happens with infrared hacking for 20 years and then two come along at once. And I was pointed to this Sky.com talk by Woody, who is somewhere in here. Raise hand, there he is. Woody's over there, and he will happily show you his hardware and things he was showing me last night in the lounge. Like just he will show you his hardware that he's developed. It's called Iris. We have one.
Somewhere.
Yeah, we have it's somewhere in our bag of hardware, and it's a really interesting talk. The video's on YouTube. You could go find it. It's called Blinded by the Lights. But what he was looking at was identifying mobile phones by the IR that they put out, which. Largely comes from the face detection on the front, so like whether you know how it knows to turn off the screen when you put it to your face and things like that. Mine, we were playing with last night, actually doesn't put out as much IR doing that, especially when the screen's off. But like the camera autofocus or autoflash—I'm not sure which one it is—like puts out a ton, which we'll show you in a second. And what he did is he had this hardware that gives you just like a binary like one bit output. And then he can like couple that with an Arduino and just build like a little embedded box that just detects phones and like knows which type of phone it is. And like if you can see a certain type of phone, it will switch on a video camera. It's actually a really neat solution, and I'm sure I'll be showing it off later. Well, there were totally pictures on this slide when
there
we
totally
wrote them.
Were.
So there were pictures of like
Wait.
R2 hardware and.
What?
You want to?
Let's
try?
Do the demo.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. But the, well, actually, I can look, I bet this will show up here. Oh, no. Wow, that's interesting. Huh. Thank you, Open Office. So we had a nice picture. We had a nice picture of Iris, but I'll just hold it up, and you can see it's small and round. it's actually designed to fit into a rifle scope, which is super awesome. Because that way you can do like long range target against it, you know, detecting a single target. The three pictures that are supposed to be up here are Iris and Gladiolus, which you've already seen, and Dominic's breadboard, which you've already seen. So I just wanted to talk really quickly about kind of why you might use any of those three different options. The basic option of just like throwing a phototransistor or a photodiode into an ADC is really useful for a lot of stuff. But this is a little bit more specialized, Iris, in that it was specifically designed for this project of fingerprinting phones at a distance by their unique signatures of their face detection proximity sensors, infrared proximity sensors that all our mobile phones have. And Woody's talk really proved kind of that these phones are fingerprintable. Even two different phones of the same model can be fingerprinted, and you can tell one from another just with a simple device like this. But this device was designed by Craig Hefner, right, for Woody's project, and it's called Iris. And it's super cool. It's basically a very sensitive photodiode with an amplifier on it. A little bit similar to gladiolus, except this one has a comparator, so that it switches. It's basically a 1-bit sampler, whereas we're doing 8-bit sampling at a higher speed. So this is not as widely capable for as many applications as gladiolus is, but it's really, really good for this one application. And one of the nice things about it is because it uses that comparator, it has a digital output. So you can plug it into an Arduino or like any microcontroller with a GPIO input, and you don't even need an analog to digital converter, and you can do a lot of cool stuff. It doesn't operate all the way down to DC, and I don't know how high in frequency it operates, but it was very effective for that one application. And then gladiolus is kind of the same approach, but taking it to the next level, where we have operation all the way down to DC, operation into several megahertz, and multi-bit sampling, so that we're able to describe a wider range of infrared signals. So let's take off the glasses so we can actually see what's going on. And let's try detecting. So I'm using this very, very simple flow graph in GNU Radio, where I'm just like taking in a signal and visualizing it right now. Can you hold your phone up against the thing? Maybe I'll think about triggering ahead of time. But you can see right off the bat, wow, we're getting a really strong signal. And this is from the camera on Dominic's phone. This is not the face detection. This is not the proximity sensor. This is a camera sensor. And if I kind of zoom out in time, can you give me some more?
Yeah.
Maybe?
There you go.
There you go. Okay, so I'm zooming out so you can kind of see the pulse train, how things operate. Now can you give me a proximity sensor?
I don't know if I can.
Oh, you don't know if you can? My phone does proximity sensor.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, call somebody. That's gonna go badly. Oh, better with a couple feet of distance. Yeah, thank you, Woody. See, he's actually done this before, unlike us. Oh, did it crash? Thanks, guys. Wow, what's going on?
To be fair, your phone's in airplane mode, so it won't make a call.
Oh!
Yeah.
I see, I was trying to be a good speaker and not have my phone ring up here, and then it turned out I wanted it. No?
I'm not getting anything.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thanks, Nick.
Very, very, very. I'm calling Mike, so do it quick.
All right. Oh, there's something. There we go. Okay. So here I'm going to zoom out again, and you can kind of see this pulse train. And so in Woody's talk, he was looking at the like timing between these pulses. And actually, it's interesting that sometimes you get these really short pulses, and sometimes you get long pulses. That's the first time I've seen that, because I haven't looked at this particular model of phone before.
Awesome.
But just looking at the timing between pulses is... is a... Just looking at the timing between pulses is enough to fingerprint phones. But we can go in much more detail than that and actually look at the waveform of how the individual pulses are modulated, which gives us even more data we can use to fingerprint phones. So even though just the timing is enough, we can get more data, and presumably we can fingerprint with a higher precision a larger number of phones. So like if we had, like Woody showed he could differentiate two different phones of the same model. Well, with more data, we could probably differentiate, you know, thousands of phones of the same model. That presumably we get, the more data we get, the more fingerprintable things are.
The torch.
Oh yeah, yeah. So there's a third way we figured out we can get infrared out of some mobile phones.
The plug was crashed again.
Yeah, of course it's crashed again. Yeah. Because, you know, we know how to write software, I think.
Hey. It's fair, but still.
This is a way we can get infrared out of phones, as it turns out. Because these bright white LEDs on the flashlight, or photo flash actually produce a little bit of IR. Sometimes, it depends on the model of phone. But I was able to like get a, at least at very close range, oh, this totally isn't gonna work, is it? It's very weak though, because primarily these things put out visible light. And secondarily, oops, that's the wrong way. Secondarily, they put out a little bit of IR. And you can kind of see, this totally isn't working. There we go. Oh, it helps if you hold it against the receiver instead of the transmitter. So anyway, you can kind of see that there's some infrared being produced by this phone. And I actually noticed, do you see, before it crashed, do you see how there was this carrier that showed up here above 1 megahertz? That is actually a modulation of this light. That is another way that this could be fingerprintable. So the flashlight on my phone is actually fingerprintable by the modulation of the LED, which I thought was kind of cool. We didn't even know that we were going to find that. We're just like, so we have like three completely different ways that we've observed LED or phones produce infrared light that is fingerprintable. And of course, we could also be doing visible light, but we're just looking at infrared for now. What's next? Yeah, I think we're gonna have a bad time with the rest of these slides from the look of things.
Wow.
I blame Nick.
There's a PDF version.
There's a PDF version. Ooh, ooh. How about that? Look,
yeah.
Have you tried turning it off and on again? Oh, look, there's our hardware comparison. Okay.
Of course, it's OpenOffice. It starts at the beginning again.
Yeah, of course. I mean, that's a user error, honestly. So infrared, IRDA is a thing. If you saw the,
here, you talk.
Okay.
Because I know where the thing is.
Okay, I know nothing about IRDA. We've, yeah. So in 8 years, we have not got better at practicing. So we looked at IRDA, and IRDA has a bunch of different modulation schemes and data rates, and apparently there's gigabit, but we've never seen a real device, and who wants to do gigabit? Maybe they do. I don't know. I'm sure there's a use case for it, but no one's building hardware. And we looked at it, and we bought some IR dongles, and we can totally look at them with our hardware, and we can receive them. The really difficult thing is getting them to work in Linux. Specifically, like, all the documentation is still like 20 years old, and like we found a guide which is for the 2.4 kernel and all this stuff. So like, I'm going to try and like bring up an interface, but what you're going to end up seeing is IRDA starts off by like signaling at a very low level and then negotiates up to a higher data rate. So the idea is that all these different devices can be compatible, and we can't get it to negotiate up to a higher data rate because we can't get it to actually communicate any data. So we're going to show at least some IRDA. I'm going
to
try.
I plugged in a dongle to your laptop, but
you.
I don't know your password.
Yet.
Yeah, they are super obnoxious. Really? You actually gave them back? I'm amazed.
Wait, Nick called something super obnoxious?
Sorry, Nick called something super obnoxious? No way. That's like super, super obnoxious. So we had trouble because we're like reading this how-to from 1999, and like speaking of 1999, I think that's the year of the ad for the Palm ad. If those of you who got here early saw while we were setting up, so this is all kind of ancient technology. Well, not all of it, but some of it. With IRDA, like we totally failed to. Actually, like have our laptops talk to each other over IRDA. We could sort of like sniff each other's discovery packets, but like getting meaningful data transfer was a challenge for us. So we don't have a high-speed IRDA demo, but we can show you what happens when we get these discovery packets going. And all right, there we go. So you can kind of see stuff happening. And this time, I think I'm gonna. Close GNU Radio and actually use in Spectrum, which is a tool, again, that Matt and Mark mentioned in the last hour. And so if I do in spectrum and give it my sample rate, which was 10.2 million, and point at this file that I just captured with GNU Radio, this is just a dump of the data that came over the USB, basically. But you can see here we have a horizontal spectrogram, so time is on the horizontal axis, and frequency is on the vertical axis. And you can maybe I can make this a little bit more, a little brighter or higher contrast. You can see there's a big DC component, which is that red horizontal line. And then you can see there are these pulses that are kind of wide band in frequency. And if I scroll, you can see there are other groups of pulses. Every group of pulses like this is a packet. And I can kind of investigate it and see. It didn't take me long to figure out. By the way, you can get the IRDA standard for a mere $650, which I thought was kind of ridiculous in 2017. But it turns out it's really easy to reverse engineer anyway, so you don't need it. Because it's just made up of these very short pulses. And each byte is transmitted as a pulse train. So here's a byte like a start. There's a start bit at the beginning of each byte. So that's a start bit with no bit set. And without a pulse, it's a 1. If there is a pulse, it's a 0. So this is like FF, 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 FF at the beginning of a packet. And then we start getting some data. This is C0. It's LSB first. And then you can just read the bits right here because they're all in a row. And if there's a pulse, it's a 0. And if there's not a pulse, it's a 1. But the pulses are quite short. And I did actually find an older version of the IRDA spec I could download. And it has kind of a variability in the pulse length that's allowed. So it's a little funny in that the symbol period or the pulse duration is the symbol period is consistent, like the time from one pulse to the next. But the actual duration of the pulse can vary quite a bit depending on what the transmitter is. But we can fingerprint that. And we could actually fingerprint that as a five-layer characteristic of an IRDA device that you wouldn't be able to do if you were just using another IRDA device to sniff the target. But this is a low-speed discovery packet that is just saying, hey, my host name is such and such. Anybody else out there? And it's operating at 9600 baud. These dongles are supposed to go up to 4 megabits per second. And so we want to be able to sniff that, but we haven't been able to actually get them to do it. But even at 9600 baud, they have very, very short pulses. And if we didn't have a high sample rate, we wouldn't be able to capture those pulses reliably because the pulses are so short. And you can see how wide band they are, that they extend like hundreds of kilohertz in bandwidth. And so we need mega sample plus sampling in order to reliably recover even this low speed IRDA just because of the pulse widths can be so short. They can be like 1 to 2 microsecond pulse lengths. So it's an interesting example, even though we didn't get the 4 megabit per second. If anybody, by the way, knows how to get to Linux devices with these dongles talking to each other at 4 megabits per second, we'd love to talk to you later. Because we have a lot more demos and a lot more target systems that we've started playing with than we have time to go through today. So we're going to be doing some continued work later. Is that it for IRDA?
Yeah, good. Jump straight to audio.
Jump straight to audio. Okay. So we have this audio system. Did you find it and plug it in and everything?
You need to
nice.
On that, the IoT.
Oh, no.
No, that's fine.
Really?
Yeah.
We're doing this.
Yeah, we're okay. I unplugged the traffic light.
Oh, you unplugged the traffic light so you don't blind yourself. He's kind of smart like that. So we turned on this audio system. And
I'll just hold it up
here. This is a little audio transmitter. Infrared audio transmitter. This is designed for automotive use. If you get a modern vehicle that has a video screen and the seat backs, something like that, those typically have an infrared audio transmitter on them. So you can wear infrared headphones at close range And now, you know, Dominic's all pimped out in his in his headphones and his so he's listening to the audio that's being transmitted by this, but the rest of us can't hear it.
It was when you weren't waving at the ceiling. But
Sorry. When I wasn't waving at the ceiling, he could hear it. But can I hear this? Is it? Are you still transmitting?
Yeah.
You have a. Is this thing on?
Maybe not. Maybe I was just not hearing anything.
Oh, there. Oh, yeah. You turn it on. Okay. Okay. So you can. So we wanna pick this up. Oh yeah. Where are your glasses? Here. Like, you can. Oh, that totally doesn't work. I wonder why that is. I don't know. Maybe your batteries are low. We want to pick this up with the Gladiolus and see what we get in GNU Radio. Oh, I just totally dropped our demo on the floor. Okay, so I made this slightly more sophisticated flow graph in GNU Radio because this is actually analog audio modulated over infrared with a carrier frequency above 2 megahertz. So like way completely different than any other infrared system that we've seen so far, much higher frequency, something that is an analog modulation, not a digital modulation, but it's something that we can deal with. Just the difference is in software. So I'm demodulating here in these three blocks the left channel of audio, and I'm at 2.3 megahertz, and I'm demodulating in these three blocks the right channel of audio. Oh, I just broke something. There we go. Undo.
Yay.
And that is operating at 2.8 megahertz. And I can capture both of those carriers at once and demodulate them and spit them out to my speakers. And maybe this will work if I start up my thing and the stuff. Where's the, here? Yeah, okay. It's a little loud. It's also a little off frequency. And it turns out that this is kind of a thing where, like, the transmitter is not very good. And I never know what frequency it's going to be on. So I have to kind of find it. And it also doesn't look very well filtered for some reason. Wait. Oh, no. I accidentally hit that slider way off to the side. This is a good test to, like, block it with your hand. That's a really good idea to test that when you're doing this stuff, because like at one point in the lab, I had a transmitter set up that was like a function generator with all this cabling and going to some LED, and then I had my receiver, and I was like, wow, I can pick this thing up from like 5 meters away. It's great. It's great. And then I like pull the LED out of the I pulled the LED out of the breadboard, and it didn't change. I could still pick it up. I'm like. Like, whoops, I accidentally a radio. And so you know, doing the hand test is a good thing.
All right, we have like 10 minutes left. So
10 minutes left.
Two more demos.
Okay, two more demos in 10 minutes. Can we do it? So we actually did it this way, too. We're just plugging a photodiode into a HackRF. Because it can do a little antenna bias and put a reverse voltage across that photodiode. It kind of worked, but only at like less than 1 centimeter. So traffic signals, right? We had heard about these traffic signal preemption systems that operate at low frequencies. Like we've been hearing about this for years. The reason we wanted to try it is because our platform is supposed to operate at very high frequencies and very low frequencies. And we're like, hey, we should try something that's very low frequencies, because we've been hearing for years that these things can be triggered with 14 hertz signals. And you know, like 10 years ago or something, this was there was a bunch of press about that, but like people have been playing with this for much longer than that. So anyway, we kind of found some traffic signal preemption systems, and we found online this really good manual for one of the popular systems, and it's made up of multiple components. There's this emitter that goes on, like on an emergency vehicle or something. And these are kind of the famous things, like, oh, the things blink and the traffic signals change. And it's made up of multiple components. And notably, this manual that we just found online confirms 14 hertz signal is high priority. It also mentions that there are these encoded pulses. You can do an uncoded signal that's just 14 hertz, or you can do something more complicated. It says something like between 14 hertz signals, there are these coded signals. We haven't investigated that in detail yet, but it's something that we should be able to do with our platform. But we wanted to just try this out. And there are some other components of the system as well. There's this detector, which is a thing that you see on top of like a pole or something. And then in a cabinet nearby, you'll see there's this phase selector, which we have here in our little enclosure, which is actually the chassis that is designed for it. Oh, he hates it when I use the word chassis. Why do you hate that, Dominic?
Look. No, I was about to be super insulting to the French. realized it's being recorded. I love the French. I love the French so much, we should say the word properly because it's pronounced chassis.
Chassis.
Enclosure is how we're going to
pronounce
it.
Enclosure. Okay. So this isn't an enclosure. This is like the real enclosure that would be in a cabinet and like nearby the traffic signal. And then this would normally be mounted on, this detector would normally be mounted on a pole or something. We just mounted it on the chassis just for our demo. And if you want to play with this stuff, be aware that like if you actually use like these emitters or something in the wild, like you're an asshole. And you're a special kind of asshole if you interfere with emergency vehicles. And there are also laws you need to be aware of. We are not lawyers, we don't give legal advice, but there are various state and local laws and at least one federal law about this stuff. These things, emitters, you can get into a lot of trouble with these things, okay? As far as we're aware, use of these in the public, like against real world traffic signals anywhere in the US is a crime. If you're not authorized, and also sale of them is a crime. So we recommend just avoiding these things entirely. However, as far as we are aware, at least in Colorado and DC, there are no restrictions on us having these, the detector and the phase selector. So we can actually see, we can just get our own preemption system and hook it up to a traffic signal, which was kindly provided by unallocated space, and try it out and see if we can make the thing trigger.
Spoiler alert, we can.
Spoiler. Okay, so we turned it against the wall so that, you know, you aren't blinded, but that means we're blinded.
I'm standing right in front of the green. That's a terrible idea. That's a terrible idea if my code works. So it's probably safe. So what I did is I threw together some code that just sends out a signal that is appropriate for this. By the way, this is like literally the most expensive demo because we bought so much hardware. We bought like multiple receivers and multiple of these. This is like $1,000 demo, and we don't even own the traffic lights. So and it's like 4 lines of code. I put together some code yesterday in the hotel room, and we attempt to do this. It doesn't work from a big distance, so I'm not going to run across the room pretending to be an emergency vehicle, and we don't have time for that, sadly. But hopefully, if I point this thing, which is just a battery pack plus a grape fet and the gladiolus, if I point this at this, hopefully the green light should come on. Oh, wow. Yes! And even though I stopped transmitting immediately as soon as it switched, it stays on for a little while, and
yeah,
you have a reason for that?
No, yes, it's meant to do that. It says that in the manual. You didn't read the manual, did you?
That is blinding.
Yeah, it is blinding. Okay, so thank you, unallocated space. We are going to donate this detector and phase selector and the whole setup to unallocated space so that they will have the ability to play with triggering their traffic signal. If you're in the area, have fun with it.
We have like 2 minutes.
We have like a minute or two. We have a few things we want to do next. There are a lot of interesting infrared systems out there, especially sensors and like LiDAR and all kinds of stuff that we're going to continue working on. thanks to a whole bunch of people. Taylor at the lab did a bunch of our hardware prep for the demos. Elizabeth is helping us write our paper. Woody, we mentioned. Skylar and Rootkilla like helped out kind of hashing out ideas for Gladiolus in our GreatFET IRC channel, unallocated, of course. Matthew and Russ were people who were also coming to us saying, oh, I think we can get you traffic signals. So we had a lot of good support for this talk. And we're going to leave you with one last fun demo because we can. And where is this? There's this fire thing, right? No.
Flame.
What is it?
GreatFET Flame.
GreatFET Flame.
Minus A.
Minus A.
Yep. Just run it.
Just run it. Okay, so this is backed by popular demand because Dominic did this at KiwiCon with stage pyrotechnics. And he's like, hey, those things put out some infrared. So now we have our own stage pyrotechnics here at Shmoocon.
Do you want to make your font bigger?
Do I want to make my font bigger?
Definitely want to make your font bigger.
I definitely want to make it. That's as big as it goes right now. Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
So very quickly, going back to earlier where I said I just moved here and like Second Amendment bought myself a plastic gun. First Amendment, free speech, blah, blah. I think you're all familiar with it. New to me, and so there's this whole thorny issue about shouting fire in a crowded theater, and we've basically got a crowded theater here, and I was like really worried about this, so I thought the best way to like get around this was to write software, because that solves all problems, and so I wrote some software that will let me know if there's a fire. So hopefully, this will work. Thank you very much. We'll take questions out in the hallway because we've definitely run over time. Cheers.
You can buy them online, but you have to add your own IR sensor. Yeah, yeah.